very much for joining. We won't keep you too long, but we're going to run through the Bit9 integration with Checkpoint, which is newly to the market, and also the merger with Carbon Black. So I'm sitting here, and alongside me is Mandeep Sandhu, who is a technical manager across EMEA. And he's going to run us through a presentation. He's also going to jump on the Carbon Black GUI and just give you a very brief synopsis of that. So any questions, we do have the chat function, so please use that. But at the end, we'll make sure that you've got all of our details so that you can contact us, and we'll come back to you, and we're happy to do one-to-one sessions with anybody afterwards as well. So I'm going to hand over to Mandeep. So let's get started.
Thank you very much, Kathy. So as Steve mentioned, I'm the technical accounts manager and the technical manager for EMEA for Bit9. And today, what I wanted to really just give you an idea about is our integration that is going to be introduced with Checkpoint. We thought we'd give you a bit of an early preview and a early access preview as to what we will be doing in terms of integration and some of the available sales tools that will be coming to you guys at some point. Also about the early access program as well. So those particular prospects that are fairly keen to actually start moving forward, if they're showing some form of interest, then we can actually give them early access to the actual technology so they can start testing the integration. Secondly, I want to run through our acquisition effectively, we call it a merger, it's an acquisition as well, of Carbon Black, which is pretty much playing around the endpoint threat detection and response space. Ideally, I want to show you the value of Bit9 and Carbon Black as a merger itself, and really just give you a bit of an overview as a little start-off point. And then if there's any further sort of interest, then we can take it at an individual level there. So Checkpoint, as you guys are already partners, you're probably aware they've got various different sort of security technologies. And where will we fit in? So currently, when we look at Checkpoint, yeah, we're looking at their firewall level and their compliance technologies. We're also looking at the encryption of local hard drives and various types of user access controls as well as devices. Also encryption of business data as well, so media encryption. And also stopping and preventing malware, stopping files from being, those machine systems from being infected, and controlling applications on the endpoint as well. And also other sort of remote access technologies as well. So there's multiple technologies that Checkpoint do play. Where we come in as an integration, it's round about the application control and blocking access blocking applications from running in your network environment. Such applications that could be considered malicious, bad, or even if it's just unapproved to run or execute at the endpoint. So how does this work? At the moment, the way we'll be doing the integration is with the Checkpoint firewalls, as well as the Threat Emulation Cloud service as well. And what we'll be introducing, and this will happen when it comes live, is the Threat Emulation Blade as well. So if you're familiar with these technologies already, Checkpoint introduced this technology last year. And these are the actual integrations that Bit9 will be running and operating with come in about 1 or 2 months' time as well. So what does the emulation do? So effectively, it's actually execution of a file in an isolated environment. So other technologies call it detonation, some call it sandboxing, just to really get an idea of if you see an executable, what does it exactly do when it runs in a contained environment? Or more so, we could say if you see a suspicious executable, what will it do in a contained environment? Yeah, which could be the real impact if it was running in an operational environment, in a production environment as well. So this is what Checkpoint's doing with this. It would obviously with the actual incoming traffic. We'll show you some of the stuff that how we do the integration on sending files to the emulation service. So what type of things will Bit9 be tracking as well? As well as the emulation service. So, when a file is written to an endpoint and it executes, if there are system changes, registry changes, or network callbacks, so a variety of things for what the output would be, which then would determine which file is going to be particularly malicious or not. And now, with that integration with Bit9, we can then determine what the policy should be. Should it allow to execute? Should it not allow to continue to run or not? So how this works, it's a two-way integration. First way is when we look at the actual network appliance from Checkpoint, traffic coming inbound, okay, will be run through its emulation service, either in the cloud, that's been sent to the Checkpoint appliance, or it's at a blade level. And once, if it's a binary executable, once that file detonates, or once it's been emulated, that data, if it's going to be of a malicious nature, will be transferred to the actual Bit9 management console. So there, what Bit9 does is an agent-based technology on the endpoint, which records activities that actually goes on the endpoint. So we're recording when a file is written to the endpoint, we'll hash that file. We also grab metadata of that particular file, in other words, what location it exists on, what machine a file would exist on as well, what did it do afterwards as well, so did it write any other new files. So that type of data is the agent that's collecting. So when we combine the hash of what's actually been sent to us by the checkpoint blade or the checkpoint service with the actual hash on the actual Bit9 agent, in other words, the agent sends that data back into the Bit9 management server, we can then correlate those events. And we can correlate those events at a global level of every managed Bit9 endpoint machine. So in other words, when Checkpoint emulates a file, it highlights something that could potentially be malicious or is malicious, what we can then say is, did that file execute on an endpoint? Which file did it execute? Which machine did it actually execute on which endpoint as well? What other related events have been associated to that particular file around a time frame, perhaps? So where we're saying the emulation is happening in a contained, vulnerable environment, Bit9's given that data around about what actually happened at the on which endpoint, and therefore what it allows an administrator to do from a security level or an incident response level is to now prioritize on which machines to actually focus on initially. And also then take some form of investigation where you can see in detail more so what's actually occurring on those endpoints. And at the same time, you could take the action to say remediate on the endpoints or servers. So if we did see something that's particularly bad, you've got the option. You can manually say, I'll now ban the execution of a file across all endpoints. Or I can create an automatic rule that says, if anything comes from Checkpoint and it says it's malicious, Bit9 ban that execution from all endpoints by its hash. That stops the lateral spread of a lot of these type of attacks that we're seeing in today's type of APTs. Secondly, okay, so when we talk about prioritize initially, so is the alert actionable? Yeah, what machines are impacted? What other files are suspicious files are involved? And again, when we look at the investigation, what else happens? So that's very key. When you're hit by an attack or a prospect or a infrastructure is hit by an attack, and say, for example, even if it's been blocked, the attacker doesn't stop then. They continue. They'll be persistent. They'll continue with different codes, different techniques to then start actually trying to infect other machines and then start to exfiltrate or whatever the intention is going to be from an attacker's point of view as well. So it's a continuous operation as well. And how do you remediate? So, yeah, do I remediate on the actual malware itself, or maybe look at something within the process of that malware or the location of that malware? How do you clean up that environment? So these are typical processes when you're doing some form of high-level incident response in how to take action upon a particular event, looking at it from both at a network level and at an endpoint level as well. So the second part of the integration is not all files will be coming from, let's say, for example, a download or the internet or via email as well. There are other vectors. So, for example, if a file comes in via USB or if a user takes a machine home at some point, and start downloading file content as well. Effectively, Bit9 has various different types of engines to analyze files on an endpoint to determine whether they are malicious or even if they're suspicious as well. So it could be that a file that's landed on an endpoint has a low trust rating from the Bit9 software reputation service, or it could be that it's a new file in the system and it's doing some suspicious activities based against some of the indicators of compromises, or what we call them advanced threat indicators, on that endpoint, that's highlighting something suspicious. So on existing systems, even when we take an inventory of all files and what's actually of high suspicion, or if there's going to be new files written to an endpoint, what Bit9 can do, if it alerts or if it raises one of those type of triggers, Bit9 will grab the binary from the actual client machine and can send it up to the actual checkpoint analysis service. And based upon that, that can be done manually, or we can create an automatic rule to look out for those type of suspicious activities to automatically send up those files to the checkpoint analysis service or the blade when that can be supported. What that means now is a lot of it's going to be automated. So the second rule, say for example, again, we've uploaded a file, Bit9's uploaded a file to the checkpoint service. They then highlight, well, after they run this in their emulation environment, they then highlight that particular file is bad. That file then gets flagged as malicious, and then it sends that notification back into the Bit9 server, and Bit9 will then have a rule that will say, I ban the execution of this particular file globally. So that's the other two-way integration that we have. All this can be managed within the Bit9 management console. There's dedicated pages that manages both the checkpoint integration within the Bit9 console. Coming in the near future, what we will be doing as well, we will be sending events, so the Bit9 data events that we're seeing on the endpoint, which is real time, sending events back into the management server, that will be sent back into the checkpoint smart response. So again, you'll have a single view of what's going on at the endpoint level as well as at the network level in both scopes. So automatic analysis, some of the questions that, when we get to customers. Is this file malicious? Yeah, what will it do if it executes? Is it trustworthy? We can then arrange that to be analyzed automatically. Yeah, or even on demand there. You may have collected an inventory of all your files on the endpoints, which Bit9 does, and associates a risk level in terms of threat and trust or suspicious activity. And then you can highlight a range of those files to be sent up to the actual checkpoint emulation service for destination, for emulation, and then as you see exactly what's been occurring on your existing environment, as well as have control on your new environment as well. Now, this is basically Bit9 operating in pure monitor mode. So we can still ban executions and block executions, even with Bit9 on the endpoint in monitor mode as well. The overall intent would be to maybe do even have a an element of application whitelisting that we have on the endpoint that Bit9 does. So even if a file has been blocked on an endpoint and they're running in a pure application whitelisting mode, the user can make a request to an administrator via an internal application. Even upon that request can be sent to the emulation blade and that, or the actual service, and based upon that result, if the file is clean, we can even say in the opposite, we can say allow the execution instead. So if we're running a default deny policy on the endpoint, There's a process that we can again use the checkpoint integration to even allow execution of the files on the endpoint as well. So it works in various different operational modes with Bit9 on the endpoints. So what we're looking at today with regards to this integration, at the moment there's a demo available. I'm not demoing this today, but any customers that have interest in this, I can show a demo. I can work with you guys to help you on this side. Then we're going to go with an early access program in April. So therefore, if you have potential prospects that maybe would like to consider something like this in their environment, we can give early access early access to the actual technology and the integration itself. You can consult with exclusive networks here if there's something or some organization that's showing that particular interest. And then we're going to go general availability towards the end of May. So this will be available for GA, fully production environment. So that's late May, that'll be actually introduced with another release of Bit9, which is 7.2, which introduces additional features as well. If you need to actually go, I will be sending a follow-up email after this with Pete, and that will be talking around any resource access. You can look at demo videos on our website as well. I'll send you these links and this various different types of collateral. That's already available today, so you can actually access this information. That will be sent after this WebEx webinar. Okay. So quoting, basically, it's just one little it's just one connector application. It's an extra license, but it's an extra license that supports all our other integration connectors as well. So it's just one license that adds on to the existing Bit9 license, and effectively that gives you the integration to any of the other vendors that we've actually worked with as well. So that's readily that could be a supplied by exclusive as well. So the second half of this was Bit9 and Carbon Black, the merger itself. Where we're at. So basically, what we believe is, these are two leaders now being one organization, one company. Yeah, from a technology point of view, when we looked at Bit9 originally, Bit9 was basically a technique to look at advanced APTs, advanced attacks, and block. Do proactive prevention mechanisms, to block the actual APT, to block the attack chain there. It's signature-less, and as we go more detail into this, I can show you more demos at some other point there. But where we introduced Carbon Black, these guys were seen as leaders in the actual instant response. So effectively, when we're looking at response to a particular area in terms of if you've got visibility of what's going on across all your endpoints, how to detect what's actually going on, and to be able to respond back within seconds or within minutes as well. The idea is to reduce the impact of something that you need to discover. So what actually drove us to actually combine with Carbon Black? Well, it's the endpoint threat detection and response market. This is a category that Gartner have developed, and they believe that this is something that's going to be of huge growth within enterprises as we lead towards, you can see that statement there, 2020 and beyond. I'm already seeing a lot of interest and impact with our integration as well. So at the moment, they're two separate technologies, and what we will be doing, we'll be combining two agents into one. The idea here is that take the best of Bit9's prevention service, the software reputation, the threat intelligence, and the threat indicators, with some of the analytic intelligence that Carbon Black is introducing. The capability of being able to detect what's going on globally within a single management console. The capability to do investigations and respond globally, but actually seeing everything that's happened from a single management console. So both technologies have this capability of recording what's going on at the end. So when we're looking at it from a prevention point of view, or watch and record, watch and recording is looking at file activities, looking at files when they execute on the endpoint. What did the file do? Looking at any file modifications, if it's registry modifications. If it, in the Carbon Black side, has it called back to a command and control center? We can tell that information from the endpoint as well. Looking at various aspects around and a particular watch list and feeds that are being sent into the actual Carbon Black technology. So if we're looking at what Bit9 does, it'll stop all untrusted software on an endpoint. We can block that type of execution, irrespective of if it's going to be malware or not. And typically, this was used within sort of critical areas, such as data centers or sort of high-targeted users, perhaps, or even fixed function systems as well. But to actually attune and achieve something like this can take a little while as well. For all other sort of dynamic users, the idea is that we have a detect and block type of structure. And that's using the combination of Carbon Black and also forming instant response as well. So having that visibility, watching and recording what's going on at the endpoint, and having all that access information in real time, yeah, proves to be a great benefit. At the moment, we've installed this in some of our existing customers, and we are already getting some great feedback in terms of being able to do an investigation, yeah, from a central management console when the machines aren't even switched on, or the machine could be somewhere else in the world already. It could be another remote site somewhere. But a full, complete investigation can be done because all the data that's sent from the actual agent is sent back into the management console in near real time. So some of the benefits, the actual agent for Carbon Black that sits on the endpoint, there's no configuration needed. You can just simply put it in place and it will start recording. It will start looking at activities of new executables. How did they execute? What did it do? Did it establish a network connection? A copy of every binary. It takes a copy of every binary on endpoints. And you can see there that we can then maintain relationships between all those different types of activities in terms of binary and also in terms of processes as well. So maintaining that relationship gives you or gives an investigator the whole life cycle details of an attack. Zero admin. That's very key. Whereas Bit9, there is some admin processes. With Carbon Black, there's zero admin. And if the actual threat intelligence, effectively this is saying that every process, every binary that Carbon Black takes a copy of and records, you can then apply intelligence feeds to that particular binary. Whether it's virus total, eyesight partners, threat connect, you can add your own intelligence feeds. It could be like the indicators of compromises that organizations have built themselves, as well as Palo Alto Wildfire, Checkpoint, FireEye, Fidelis, as you can see in that list of feeds there. So you can have multiple different feeds to a single record that goes on at the endpoint. So this is a bit of a viewing of the Carbon Black management GUI. So what processes are vulnerable? What part of the kill chain do we need to take a look into? As well. 2 seconds. So what I will show is I'll give you a bit of a show of actually this little piece of mapping. But what I'll do, I'll show that as a demo here. It's a very, very, very quick demo. So this particular case, this is actually showing the Carbon Black interface. We can take a look at some of the events that have been going on per incident. So for example, what module has been loaded, when was it loaded. I'm not going to show you that. That's more detail. That's going to be a bit more technical. Here we've seen a process where notepad.exe spawned a child process. Yep. So it spawned a child process, and notepad.exe ran command.exe. So that's not particularly a usual type of activity. So this is the type of stuff that Carbon Black's recording. Command.exe then ran net.exe. Net.exe ran net1.exe. And we actually are now seeing data exactly what's been ran. So for example, this one that's highlighted yellow, net.exe, was actually trying to add bad guy and add it to the actual domain itself. So we can actually see details of that net.exe, okay, as well as everything that it did in terms of net.exe. Net1.exe, again, or conhost.exe, or more command.exe as well. Yeah, here we go. So as you can see, we can build a tree exactly what's actually going on or what happened and take a history view of what went on going forward from notepad.exe. But at the same time, you may want to say that, okay, notepad.exe came from PowerShell.exe. What actually wrote PowerShell? Yeah, why did that happen? So PowerShell.exe was spawned internally, again, at some point as well. And we can see that command.exe ran PowerShell.exe. So you can see now we're building the whole chain of this actual attack event. As well as we can see here, command.exe for that spawned PowerShell.exe was Java. And Java was the actual top process by looking at it, by a launcher. So here we can identify that Java.exe was vulnerable something had been injected into that, and it started to do all these type of activities here. This type of stuff, this type of investigation data, can take weeks or actually months to actually pick up and identify what's gone at the endpoints there. Whilst what we're identifying is exactly what's happened within seconds here. So incident response within seconds at a global level. So more detail can be given around what other machines had actually have got a particular bad file. So we can now start correlating events, and then we can now start to we can associate to investigations. So an example could be of a checkpoint. If you see a particular callback, yeah, you could effectively say, I'll put the IP address in a, let's say, for example, a process search. I'll put an IP address, and the detail from the endpoint will give you every single process that's been associated to that particular IP address, and then you can now start looking at various different components, did it modify the registry, file modifications, net connections, etc. There. So that's just a very quick overview of Carbon Black. I mean, that's just like a very high level. There's more to that, but the benefit here is there's no configuration. You've got global points of investigation as well. You can see this example. It's the same example which I've shown, just showed you here, but I thought it would be better to show you actually in action as well. So at the moment, the license model is whoever purchases Bit9 receives Carbon Black and vice versa as well. So whoever purchases Carbon Black receives Bit9. At the moment, I'm actually running a early access program as well. And with that early access program, you'll be able to request for a pilot or an evaluation there. So if there's any particular questions on that side, that comes to is very basically an overview of both Checkpoint and Carbon Black. But if there's any questions, you can either email myself or Peter as well.
Thanks, Mandeep. It's Peter here again. I have opened up the chat function. Apologies, I don't think that was working earlier. So we'd encourage any questions now. Hopefully that's given you an intro overview as to the Checkpoint and the Bit9 and the Carbon Black integration with Bit9. The guys are going to be at Intersec, which is scarily coming up upon us next month. So they're going to have their own booth there, and obviously it's a good place to come and visit them. We're happy to do one-to-one WebExes. We appreciate that we haven't gone into too much detail on the technical side here. So we're happy to come and do one-to-ones with you either face-to-face or on a call. So alternatively, please get in touch with myself and Mandeep. What we're going to do is I'm going to thank you for attending. We're going to sit here for the next 5 to 10 minutes on the line. So if you have any questions, please do message us, and then we'll answer them. So from us at the moment, that's it. But thank you very much, and please send us any questions that you have.
Thank you.